there. I'm Deacon Henry Cugini. Some of you may know me. I'm a deacon here at the Co-Cathedral of St. Robert's. And I'm going to talk to you today about adoration and Eucharistic miracles. And I'm going to try to the best of my ability explain to you what they are. I also want to talk to you about how important you are and why it's important for each and every one of you to understand what adoration is, what the Blessed Sacrament is, what the Eucharistic miracles are, and what the Eucharist is. So it's going to be a little tutorial, I guess, but just bear with me. So behind me is the tabernacle, and the tabernacle is where our Lord is kept. Once consecrated by the priest, that is the housing, if you will, of our Lord. So when we come into church, we always reverence the tabernacle. And next to it is the monstrance. And during adoration and during benediction, this monstrance, the circle here, is where the large host fits in. When you, the word adoration, when you adore, I'm sure for those of you that, yeah, I don't know, maybe you have boyfriends and girlfriends at this age, and I'm sure maybe you adore them. Hopefully you adore your parents. But I've actually got good news for you, and we'll talk about adoring. I'm sure you guys know Olivia Rodrigo. Well, I've got some good news for you. For those of you who don't know her, she was at the White House and did some stuff there. But for, I want to let you know that in 1, 2, 3 weeks from now, Olivia will be here at St. Robert's. So I'm going to, at the end of this little presentation, invite each and every one of you to join me with her here at St. Robert's. Now, logistically, I don't know how that's going to work for you. You don't drive, so you're going to have to get to church somehow, and I'm hoping that you will, but I kind of have a funny feeling that you will. She's famous, and I know she's cool, and we were trying to get a hold of, what was his name? Logan Paul, because I know he does a lot with, I think it's Logan Paul, does a lot with TikTok, but we couldn't get him, and I know you all know what TikTok is. So that'll be a fun time for you. But how are you going to get here? How are you going to take, she'll be here for about an hour, maybe a little longer. How are you going to take an hour out of your busy day to be here? That's a question that I need you to figure out. Are you going to get your parents here? Are you going to come with friends? Maybe some of you can walk to church. I don't know. But how do you get here? And why get here? Because I assume maybe we can use the word adore or adoration. There's a lot of adoration and maybe admiration for Olivia. And maybe that's how you feel. I do have to confess, though, I'm telling you a fib. And the reason why I'm doing that is to prove a point. I'm sure by now you're all going crazy. Maybe you're on your phones texting everybody that Olivia is going to St. Robert's or going to be at St. Robert's. She's not. She's not. My point is, though, that if someone is famous, you want to be with them. You want to be around them. You adore them. It's an adoration. Well, I've got news for you, my friends. Jesus is here every minute of the day, every Sunday, when we celebrate Mass and the priest consecrates the bread and wine into the body and blood, the Eucharist. It's Jesus here, not in heaven, not 1,000 miles away, not a storybook, but present here at the altar. And right now, actually, Jesus is here. So if you would come here for Olivia and make an hour out of your, take an hour out of your busy day and have your parents come or make plans for you to come, why would you not spend an hour a week with Jesus? Why not spend an hour a week with the God who created you? I need you to think about that. I really do need you to think about that. Now, I'm married. I have 4 children, 3 grandchildren. All of my own children have completed college. 2 of them are teachers. Actually, 3 of them were, but 1 is not now. And they're out in the world. And it concerns me that you guys are going to be out in the world in high school and confronted with, asked to do things which you may be uncomfortable in doing. How do you say no? What gives you the strength and the courage to be different and say, no, I'm not going to smoke that. No, I'm not going to take that pill. No, I'm not going to do this. No, I'm not going to do that. I get it. But what gave me the strength to say no was Jesus. What gave me the strength to say no was receiving the Eucharist as often as I possibly could. It was definitely once a week, and often I was at daily Mass. So what about you? Now I get it. You don't drive. And maybe it is that your parents can't get here or don't take you. Or maybe it is that you're busy with sports. But I know as sure as I'm standing here, if Olivia was coming in a couple of weeks, you would have canceled everything to be here. You would have driven your parents crazy to make sure that you were here. And I get it. Jesus is here. The God that can help you with anything, help you with everything, the God that loves you, that created you, why not just spend some time and adore him, worship him, talk to him? You may know all of your prayers by now. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Good. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Good. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, hey God, I'm in trouble. Hey God, I need help. Or hey God, my parents are driving me crazy. Or hey God, how about this one? Hey God, I'm driving them crazy. How do you deal with it? Who do you go to? Your friends? Do you trust your friends more than you do God? Maybe you do. That's something to think about. But when you take an hour a day and you go to Mass, yeah, maybe you don't like the standing and the sitting and the kneeling and the singing. Okay, but it's you and God. It could have been you and Olivia. You would have sat there and, oh, you know, how great this is. I get it. When I was your age, there were idols that I had too. Baseball, you know, guys, and yeah. I'm going to be 68 years old. They've all come and gone. They've all gotten older. God was as young as he was, as young as he is today, as he was the day I was born, and he was 2,000 years ago, and is still here to listen to me, to help me, and more importantly, for me to talk to. He knows what I need before I ask. So why not sit there? And I'm sure in your CCD class now, you will have an opportunity have the monstrance there, to have the Eucharist there, and to sit in a quiet, cool, a little dark church, either here in the chapel or over in the church, and to sit and just be quiet. And you say to yourself, okay, God, this crazy deacon told me that you're here. What do we do now? Okay, get out of the way and watch out, because you just may find out. God will speak to you in his own way and touch you and help you and answer you and give you whatever it is you may need. Believe me. And maybe you're saying, well, this round piece of bread here, this tasteless, odorless communion that I received X number of years ago, it's a wafer. How can that be the body of Christ? How can the wine that's poured from that bottle be the blood of Christ? What is that all about? We're drinking, we're having bread and wine, we're having dinner, and that's supposed to be the body and blood of Christ? Correct. This is the table. The altar is the table, and Jesus feeds us with his body and blood. So, I can hear you already. I'm a mind reader. I know what you're saying. Sure, Yeah, Deacon. Okay. Bread and wine, body and blood, baloney. Really? Well, in a minute, and actually the video started, you will see a Franciscan friar from Luciano telling you about a priest who maybe felt the same way you do, who maybe had the same doubts that you do. And what happened? He asked God, let me know that you're here. Answer my questions. Let my doubts go away. And I told you before, when you ask God, let me know you're here, get out of the way. Well, somebody should have told that priest to get out of the way. Because what happened is, when he was consecrating it and said the prayers, the Eucharist, that piece of bread, that tasteless little round thing, actually became the body of Christ. And within that, it turned into the blood of Christ. And you will see in a few minutes. Today, if you travel to that town, in a monstrance different than this and larger, you will actually see the Eucharist from, I'm not going to remember the dates now, but the Eucharist that has been there for hundreds of years, still there, changed into the body and blood of Christ. Sure, Deacon, you can say that. Two popes. It was Pope Paul VI, and then a doctor afterwards actually was allowed to take particles of the Eucharist and particles of the blood that congealed, that got a little rubbery, into five separate globules, if you will, and actually tested them. They have found that the Eucharist to be heart tissue, human heart tissue, and the blood to be human blood, still alive, not 300 years old, but still alive. And they've tested the blood type to be blood type AB, and AB was the generic blood type that was around in the area that Christ lived. So this priest, humble man that he was, had a little bit of a faith problem maybe, did not believe that little aspect, or was confused about it, or whatever, asked our Lord, let me know that you're here. And what did Jesus do? He answered his prayer. And the body and blood of Christ still literally sits in that church, the same way the body and blood of Christ sits here. So to go full circle, my good friends, to go full circle. Adoration is important. This God of ours will do anything that you need. Is he going to make you a millionaire tomorrow? Come on. You know what I mean. What you need, you will get in faith. When you sit before him and talk to him, pray to him. And I'm not saying that you have to sit there, and you certainly can. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You can. That's a prayer Jesus taught us. Or Hail Mary, or Glory Be, or whatever standardized prayer. The way you talk to your friend, you talk to God. Respectfully, of course. God, I'm having trouble with this. I need help with this. I'm afraid. I'm happy. Thank you for this. Or God, I don't know what to do here. Help me. I promise you, if you are sincere in heart and you ask God, you will receive whatever you need. It is my prayer for you, for all of you, you youngsters. You are the future of the church. You are the church. You are the body and blood of Christ in person out there. We need you. You need us. We need to be church together. So I ask you to spend a little time with the video that you're going to see and pray about it. My prayer is that God continue to bless you and remain with you forever. Amen. God bless you all.
Ave Maria, welcome back to No Apologies. As we continue to take a look at some Eucharistic miracles showing the true presence of our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament, today we're going to look at the miracle of Lanciano, Italy, which many consider to be the greatest Eucharistic miracle ever. And this miracle took place in the year 750 in the church of St. Francis of Assisi in Lanciano, Italy, where, just similar to our miracle of Bolsena, there was a priest who came to celebrate Mass who was having doubts about our Lord's presence in the Blessed Sacrament. But unlike Bolsena, when this priest reached the words of consecration during the Mass, the host didn't begin just to seep blood, but actually turned into a piece of flesh, and the blood and the wine turned into actual blood. Everyone who was in attendance at the Mass witnessed the miracle, and today the flesh is still intact, and the blood has coagulated into five separate globules of varying shapes and sizes. Well, both are on display for the public adoration of the faithful. And in the year 1970, the Archbishop of Lanciano and the Provincial Superior of the Conventual Franciscans, who are in charge of the shrine, requested Dr. Edward Linoli to conduct a scientific study of the two relics. And Dr. published his results, and here are some of his scientific conclusions. First is that he confirmed that it was indeed flesh and blood of the human species. And second, he concluded that the flesh is actually a dissected section of a human heart. And he identified the myocardium, the endocardium, the vagus nerve, and also the left ventricle of the heart for the large thickness of the mitochondria. And fourthly, he concluded that the flesh and the blood were of the same blood type, which is AB, which is also the same blood type which is found on the Shroud of Turin. And fifthly, he discovered that in the blood there was found, still 12 centuries later, all the proteins and the minerals which are found in freshly shed blood. And in sixth, he concluded that there were no traces of any kind of salt infiltrations or other preservative substances which would have been used for the purpose of embalming. Now, just 2 years after Dr. Leonoli published his results, the Chief Advisory Board of the World Health Organization appointed a scientific commission to collaborate with Leonoli's findings. And their work lasted for 15 months and included 500 scientific tests. And they verified also that the fragments couldn't be likened to any kind of embalmed flesh. And as to the nature of the fragment of flesh, the commission actually declared it to be living tissue because it responded rapidly to all the clinical reactions distinctive of living beings. So in the end, it was published in December of 1976, and we quote, that science, aware of its limits, has come to a halt, face to face with the impossibility of giving an explanation. Thanks for joining me here on No Apologies. Ave Maria.